Dear Frank, I once knew a pious old lady who never saw or heard anything in this world that did not put her in mind of Joseph in Egypt. Whenever anything was told her, no matter what, she would take a pinch of snuff and exclaim with a devotional air, "Ah, that puts me in mind of Joseph in Egypt." Nobody could tell why, but so it was. In traversing this mountain region, one of the first things that struck me was the solemn, severe silence which prevailed everywhere and only broken at distant intervals by the note of the cock of the woods, the chirping of the ground squirrel, the crash of a falling tree, or the long echoes of a fowler's gun, which rendered the silence thus broken in upon a moment still more striking. In many places, the only traces of human agency are the incisions of the sugar maple and the little troughs at the foot of the tree turned upside down to await the flowing of the sap in the spring. In one of the taverns along the road, we were set down in the same room with a man who was an ill-looking, hard-featured, pockmarked, bearded fellow. He was going, it seems, to Richmond. "All along the road, I made it my business to inquire where lived a man who might perhaps be tempted to sell me his slaves, and when I got some half a dozen of them, I tied their hands behind their backs and drove them 300 or 400 miles or more, bareheaded and half naked. I gave out that they were runaway slaves. I was carrying them home to their masters. On one occasion, a black woman exposed his fallacy and told the story of her being kidnapped. And when I got her into a wood out of hearing, I beat her till her back was white. I made all the men and women I bought because they would sell better for being a man and wife. For many is the time I've separated wives from husbands and husbands and wives and parents from children. But then I made amends by marrying them again as soon as I had a chance. I made one bad purchase there. I bought a young mulatto girl, a lovely creature, a great bargain. She'd been a favorite of a master who lately married. The difficulty was to get her to go, for she loved her master. However, I swore most bitterly that I was only going to take her to her mother, and she went with me, though she seemed to doubt me very much. But when she discovered at last that we were out of the state, I thought she would go mad, and in fact the next night drowned herself in the river close by. I lost a good $500 by this foolish trick.
It is seldom we see the ties of kindred or of conjugal affection stronger than in the Negro. He will travel 12, 15, or 20 miles to see his wife and children after his daily labor is over and return in the morning to his labor again. If he obtains his liberty, he will often devote the first years of his liberty to buying their freedom.
I got this from Uncle Dewey, because he spoke for Black History Month down here. He said that somebody told the mistress there were four little foxes down there looking out the window. She got the market basket and went down, thought he was talking about animals, and they were the little Negro children. So, of course, she told the master. So he said, well, just bring them on up here, and he put them in the kitchen. And he said they would take a tub, like a foot tub, and put bread in and milk, pour it in there, and they ate with the cats and dogs under the kitchen table. But by being at the big house, they learned to talk, they learned to read, they just learned things. When you around, you pick up. They were not back there in the field somewhere. So one of them became a preacher, one of them became a cook, and that one, I think, we would say like a butler. He was something like, if you saw Roots, he was like Chicken John. And as I said, the girl, they lost trace of her. Steve went to Ohio, so they lost trace of him. And so, and Father John, see, he bought the oxen, and he cut lumber. He was known as the lumberjack. And if you would read the history of St. Paul's Church, it was John Fox, that's my grandfather. It was George Johnson, grandfather on my mother's side, a Carter, and I think three other men bought that piece of land where that church is. They paid for it. And a lot of the lumber in the church, John Fox gave.
In 1754, the New Light Baptists, led by Shubal Stearns, came down from Connecticut, crossed into Virginia at the Opequan, and clashed head-on with the Episcopal Church, the state religion. On farms and plantations, they inhabited their inner kingdom and together invented and sang out truth in the lion's den. But using these newly learned biblical stories, they confounded the lion. At any quiet moment together, one might test a tune and sing it into the silence, and the others study it, some adding a harmony, or the first person would make the tune or beat better, Others might join, then more might, and a mountain would begin to move, lifting hearts. With the U.S. Colored Troops, the 23rd Infantry Regiment, on the eve of the Battle of the Crater, July 30, 1864. Studying. Strolling often around the camp, their commander, Henry G. Thomas, observed later, "Any striking event or piece of news was usually eagerly discussed by the white troops, and in the ranks, military critics were as plenty and perhaps more voluble than among the officers. Not so with the blacks. Important news was usually followed by long silence. They sat about in groups, studying, as they called it. They waited, like the Quakers, for the spirit to move. And when the spirit moved, one of their singers would uplift a mighty voice, like a bard of old, in a wild sort of chant. If he did not strike a sympathetic chord in his hearers, if they did not find in his utterance the exponent of their idea, he would sing it again and again, altering sometimes the words, more often the music, if his changes met general acceptance. One voice, after another, would chime in. A rough harmony of three parts would add itself. Other groups would join his, and the song would become the song of the command. The joyous Negro guffaw always breaking out about the campfire ceased. They would form circles in their company streets and were sitting on the ground intently and solemnly studying. And as usual, as it would happen, at last, a heavy voice began to sing. Over and over again he sang it, making slight changes in the melody. The rest listened to him intently. No sign of approval or disapproval escaped their lips or appeared on their faces. All at once, when his refrain had struck the right response in their hearts, his group took it up, and shortly, half a thousand voices were upraised, extemporizing a half dissonant middle part and bass. It was a picturesque scene, these dark men, with their white eyes and teeth and full red lips crouching over a smoldering campfire in dusky shadow, with only the feeble rays of the lanterns of the first sergeants and the lights of the candles dimly showing through the tents. The sound was as weird as the scene. When all the voices struck the low E, last note but one, held it, and then rose to A with a portamento as sonorous as it was clumsy, until we fought the Battle of the Crater. They sang this every night, to the exclusion of all other songs. July 23rd, 1850, a full moon. The quarter of A.S. Dandridge, Leetown, then Virginia. Ooh, 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 ooh. Traveling diarists across Virginia reported for decades that the black workers were incredibly fit, slept little, sharing the wee hours in a joyous private world. At 4 o'clock in the morning, smoke was still rising from the huts of the Negroes. They have fire during the entire night, and in the hottest season. Often instead of sleeping, they smoke, sing, or converse without that loss of sleep affecting them. Almost all of them, after a night devoted to pleasure, can take up their labor without experiencing that weariness that a white man would feel who had been deprived of his rest. I never met a Negro man, unless he is quite old, that he is not whistling, and the women sing from morning till night. And as to dancing, the hardest day's work does not restrain their desire to indulge in such pastime. During the harvest, when their toil is pushed to its utmost, they dance almost the whole night. At the bower that I know well, I have seen that they are also great sportsmen. They angle and haul the seine, and hunt and tend their traps with a zest that never grows weary. Their gaiety of heart is constitutional and perennial. And when they are together, they are voluble and noisy. In short, I think them the most good-natured and happily constructed human beings I have ever seen. They are by far the most musical of any portion of the inhabitants of the United States. And in the evening, I have seen them playing on the banjo, singing in a style, I dare say, equal to a Venetian gondolier. And then they whistle as clear as the notes of the fife. And their laugh is the very echo of hilarity. He will make himself happy in the traps that have been laid for him. He will roll in their nets and sleep. All doors will fly open to him who has a mildness more defiant than mere courage. He will always be taken in. To be taken in everywhere is to see the inside of everything. You sang away being owned. Yes, yes, yes. Any day before the Civil War, the Bower echoed with the overseer's tin trumpet at 4 a.m., little boys and young men chopping firewood for the fireplaces in the main house, carrying buckets of water from the Opekan, a house servant pouring it into bedroom pitchers and bowls, and into the cast iron kettle still warm over the night's coals, tossing old water from chamber pots in the families' and their guests' bedrooms, then helping the ladies dress and groom for breakfast. Water and hay and oats for the stables of thoroughbred and workhorses. Fresh hay from the barn fills the wagon in the front yard, nibbled on by mules, donkeys, and livestock. Those who have visited will long remember the morning stir, the dry rubbing of floors, and even the waxing of the same until they were like ice, and the grinding of coffee mills and the gibber of ducks and chickens and turkeys. The cows were milked. I am occasionally up early enough to witness my cousin's, the mistress, morning regimen, which to my mind is rather tyrannically enforced against the youngsters, both white and black. She is in the habit of preparing some death-routing decoction for them in a small pitcher and administering it to the whole squadron in succession, who severally swallow the dose and gallop off with faces all rue and wormwood. Craftsmen repair to their stations. Lucy's family was remarkable for its intelligence, and those who had already left had been selected for the mechanical employments upon the estate. And they were shoemakers, weavers, or carpenters, and were held in esteem for their industry and good character. After the breakfast table is cleared and cleaned, napkins are tossed in with a kettle full of heated water. Sweeping, polishing, mopping, and dusting, sometimes turning the mattresses over, and begin preparing midday supper. And always the spinning of sheep's wool for carpets and sewing, making for the workers shirts in the spring, and wool clothes, shoes, and a blanket, and a coat in the fall. Sudden visitors and parties exponentially increase the work. Every day, week, month, and year, an eternity of active verbs. The resources of the house were manifest. Fat cattle in the pastures, poultry in the surrounding hills, many gardens in the rich bottom lands in front, with 50 servants always at one's beck and call. Back of the house lay numerous terraces and plots, planned by the artistic taste of my grandmother. We gloated on the paradisical beauty of the beloved home and loved to put a wealth of flowers about it. then there was always a chink in the armor of the bower's pose of cloudless congeniality. Its owners, often young and inheriting vast lands and dozens of human beings willed on them without their say, would often live too well, too sociably, thus committing the Thomas Jefferson violation. Thomas Jefferson struggled, owning too many people from his wife's dowry, but insisting on his wines and fanciful projects. When the day came, his accountant told him the fact that he could lose Monticello for debts. The face of Thomas Jefferson paled in horror. So he sold people, people that were born and grown at Monticello. To his overseer Joel Yancey, Thomas Jefferson wrote with a vile hypocritical air that the labor of a breeding woman is more profitable than the crop of the best laboring man. Monticello, January 17, Sunday. The mortality among our Negroes is still more serious as involving moral as well as interested considerations. They are well fed and well clothed, and I have no reason to believe that any overseer since Griffin's time has overworked them. Accordingly, the deaths among the grown ones seem ascribable to natural causes, but the loss of five little ones in a year induces me to fear that the overseers do not permit the women to devote as much time as is necessary to the care of their children, that they view their labor as the first object and their raising their child but as secondary. I consider the labor of a breeding woman as not objectionable, and that a child raised every 2 years is of more profit than the crop of the best laboring man. In this, as in all other cases, Providence made our interests and duties coincide perfectly. Women, too, are destroyed by exposure to wet at certain periodical indispositions to which nature has subjected them. With respect, therefore, to our women and their children, I must pray you to inculcate upon the overseers that it is not their labor, but their increase, which is the first consideration with us. January 17, 1819, Thomas Jefferson.
Now, getting by. Our people was at the bow. See, we learned this. And all we know that our grandmother, first name was Murray. That's all we know was Murray. They decided that they were gonna stop buying slaves, having them shipped over here because they come over on those boats, they're all tired, they get sick and everything, and so many of them would die. So we will take so many of these strong women and we will just have children. So let them bear the children here. And they picked her for one, but she refused it. So of course you don't tell your masters what you're not going to do. So Uncle Dewey said they lost, they saw of their mother. She was in. A wagon with one horse pulling it, tied in there, and they were beating her. So these was left in the cabinet. Up on the bow is a house they call the Fox's House. So that's where they were. One was named Umford, one was named Benjamin, one was named Steve, one was named John, and a girl named Mary. I guess she named after her mother. Umford, he lived in a house up there. They called it Pine Hills then. Probably was up on that damaged land. Steve went to Ohio, so they lost trace of him. Benjamin was the little preacher, and he was down in Virginia. Mary went to Pennsylvania, Kalau, and lost trace of her. Now my brother went up to Kalau and was searching around, and he found this Mary Shadden living up there. But before he could finish the research, he died. So it just stopped there. I asked the lady Holmes that came down. She said, yeah, it was boxes up there, but she didn't know what's what.
During the interview in May 2002, did Jim Surkamp's question, what happened to their mother, Mary? Bertha turned her head, looked at me incredulous, and said, they killed her. By whom? The overseer for the Bower, Henry Swigert, had been killed in a train accident in the mid-1850s, just when the debt-ridden farm of another Dandridge sibling to Adam Stephen was collapsing and its enslaved persons were being sent south. It's plausible that his overseer, Davy Hunter, took up the responsibilities at the Bower where he was needed and to fill in Swigert's place. That the 1860 census lists the Bower owner, Adam Stephen, as being disabled by blindness suggests the responsibilities of running a place during that time may have devolved over to Hunter. Adam Stephen in 1860, according to the census, did not live at the main house, but alone with his blindness in a smaller dwelling nearby, presumably for care and personal safety from injury. Charles Fox, Mary's great-great-grandson, writes, 4.5 generations ago and 6 miles away from Papa's. Mary, a handsome mulatto woman, lifts the long skirt to her plain cotton dress. And slips down the wooden steps from the rear of the bower. Beneath the luminescent smile of the waning moon, the shadow of a large two-story brick federal structure rises above her. Looking back, she makes sure no one detects her. Soft, warm flickers of light from the sitting room fireplace are the only movement in the windows as she disappears into the night. Especially in the dark, Mary is sure-footed and quick. The midwife taught her that plants absorb light and hardened soil reflects it. So, in the black of night, if she focuses on the ground, the worn path's subtle glow will reveal the way through the darkness to the quarter farm. Her children were hidden there. If the master did not know about her children, and there was no record, they would be able to escape. That's what Mary envisioned. When a voice pierced the darkness, "Where are you going?" It was the Irish overseer hired by the master to watch over the property. Since Mary and the midwife conspired to report her children as stillborn, neither the master, his wife, nor the overseer knew that Mary had given birth to 5 healthy children. So, the children had not been listed on the master's inventory of slaves and property. Mary might not ever see freedom in her lifetime, yet the brilliance of her cunning persistence to free her children shone like the light only she could see in the darkness. "I said, where are you going? I'm not going to ask you again." Distracting her questioner's attention from the light she followed, Mary straightens her posture and turns to face him with fists tightened. Then she extends her hands, opens them, and reveals leftovers of food balanced in her palms. "Just going to feed some little baby foxes been abandoned by their mama." Charles Fox wrote, "Mary, my great-great-grandmother, a handsome mulatto woman in her 30s, tied to a wagon wheel, is beaten and taken away in the back of a horse-drawn wagon. Like the old oak trees pay witness, so does old midwife Lucy, keeper of dreams and secrets, older than Enoch. Devil winds raise fallen leaves of whispered questions. What about the children? Was the mother sold? Was she killed? What children?" Master turned and walked away, not looking back, a descendant reports. Shame, a secret pain, like footprints mark his trail. The Fox family history, coming down from John Fox, describes Adam Stephen Dandridge as deeply despondent after Mary's death. "He went on a 4-day drunk in the woods." Adam Stephen instructed that the 5 Fox children, all younger than 10, be brought into the big house to be raised. They were fed in the kitchen from a big bowl of milk and bread with the cats and dogs. But Bertha stresses, they learned to read and write. Dewey Fox, John Fox's son, also passed on to Bertha that Mrs. Adam Stephen Dandridge, Serena Catherine, and the mistress of the house would sometimes dab the children's lips with a greasy substance for reasons only known to her. John Pendleton Kennedy, a real-life cousin to Mrs. Adam Stephen Dandridge, used his observations of her in his famous reflection called Swallow Barn that he firmly said was not a made-up novel. He called his cousin Lucretia. Everything at Swallow Barn that falls within the superintendence of my cousin Lucretia is a pattern of industry. In fact, I consider her the very priestess of the American system. Moreover, all things go like clockwork. She rises with the lark and infuses an early vigor into the whole household. And yet she is a thin woman to look upon, and feeble with a sallow complexion, and a pair of animated black eyes which impart a portion of fire to a countenance otherwise demure from the paths worn across it. But although her life has been somewhat saddened by such visitations of ague, my cousin is too spirited a woman to give up to them, for she is therapeutical in her constitution and considers herself a full match for any reasonable tertian in the world. Indeed, I have sometimes thought she took more pride in her leechcraft than becomes a Christian woman. She is even a little vainglorious. Men say what they choose about it being contrary to reason and all that. It is their way, but seeing is believing. 9 scoops of water in the hollow of the hand from the sycamore spring for 3 mornings before sunrise and a cup of strong coffee with lemon juice will break an ague. Try it when you will. I am occasionally up early enough to witness her morning regimen, which to my mind is rather tyrannically enforced against the youngsters, both white and black. She is in the habit of preparing some death-routing decoction for them in a small pitcher and administering it to the whole squadron in succession. In the home department, she is confessedly, without appeal, the paramount power. Were there emotions between Mary, the owned one, and Adam Stephen Dandridge, Serena Catherine's husband? Two mothers. On future legal documents, a marriage certificate and a death certificate, brothers Humphrey and John Fox did not list Mary as their mother, but John Fox as their father, and their mother as Betsy Dennis. Perhaps after Mary's death, Betsy Dennis may have been the midwife who delivered all the 5 children, a secret shared. Philip C. Pendleton, Power in a Velvet Glove. The man most likely to have uncovered the existence of Mary's unlawful family, and was also the man who had the legal power to do something about it, was Philip C. Pendleton, the man who held the lives, hopes, and fates of all persons of color in a jurist's balance, the one who visited the quarter regularly to hobnob and check up on things, and who, beneath his languorous patrician air, really ran things, making sure debts were paid. He was the brother of Sarah Pendleton Dandridge, the widow of Adam Stephen Dandridge I, mother of Adam Stephen Dandridge II, and in the many remaining years that she lived until the mid-1850s, her brother Philip Pendleton, a lawyer and one-time judge, controlled and managed all the land and property and people as he saw fit in the estate of his sister's husband. He was to be feared. He was the lead executor at 3 advertised auctions of people on Bower Land and the Quarter. John Pendleton Kennedy renamed his uncle Philip C. Pendleton Frank Merriweather in Swallow Barn, that is to say, the Bower, but keeping the facts of Pendleton intact. Kennedy retreated from using an account found only in his first draft of the notorious hate stare of Pendleton's. After a slave had grinned saucily and good-humoredly at his master's stupidity, it is said that my uncle looked up at the black with the most awful face he ever put on in his life. It was blood red with anger, but bethinking himself for a moment, he remained silent as if to subdue his temper. He did not speak one word. If he had not constrained himself by his silence, he would probably have attacked his slave with a stick. Frank Merriweather has, by arrangement, taken possession of the inheritance together with the family. Ned has ample liberty to pursue his own whims in regard to his future occupation in life. Ned Hazard was Adam Stephen Dandridge II, renamed, but the real-life details remain intact. Kennedy continues about his relative. It pains me to say that Hazard's days of academic glory at Princeton were untimely cropped, but my veracity as a chronicler compels me to avow, even to the disparagement of my friend, that before his course had run its destined end, he made shipwreck of his fortunes and received from the faculty a passport that warranted an unquestioned egress from Nassau Hall. Ned crept quietly back to Swallow Barn, and in the lonely pursuits of this period, he engendered that secret love of adventure and picturesque incident that took him upon his celebrated expedition around the Horn. But it in no degree conquered his mirthful temper. His mind is still a fairyland inhabited by pleasant and conceited images, winged charmers, laughing phantoms, and mellow specters of frolic. Frank holds the estate for the present under an honorable pledge to relieve it of its burdens by a gradual course of thrifty husbandry.
Look her over, she's 56, but got a lot of years left in her, you can bet.
In the quarter, most of these own people lived in picturesque moss-covered cabins, dotting the hillside on the 443-acre landscape. We observing their gardens, roiling and cymbling cucumbers, sweet potatoes, watermelons, and cabbages, dodging chickens, past welcoming doorstep mothers and darting little children, going into their homes unannounced, and I insert possibly the way Uncle Philip could have found out Mary's secret unregistered children. Kennedy goes on. He has constituted himself into a high court of appeal and makes it a rule to give all their petitions a patient hearing and to do justice in the premises. In almost every house where he entered, there was some boon to be asked, and I observed that in every case, the petitioner was either gratified or refused in such a tone as left no occasion or disposition to murmur. Most of the women had bargains to offer of fowls or eggs or other commodities of household use, and Philip generally referred them to his wife. "That, sir," said Pendleton, "is no less a personage than Jupiter. He's an old bachelor, and he has his cabin here on the hill. He's now near 70, and is a kind of king of the quarter. He has a horse which he extorted from me last Christmas, and I seldom come here without finding myself involved in some new demand as a consequence of my donation. Now he wants padding for his saddle, which he said galled his creature's back." Kennedy adds, and after a few jocular passages with the veteran, Uncle Philip gave him what he desired. I add, Mary's secret would be found out in the quarter one day. Then, one day,
our grandmother, first name was Mary, as all we know was Mary.
This foolish trick. This foolish trick.
My great-great-grandmother, Mary, she is spoken of as she really walked in the bower's autumn oak leaves, across the wooden planks of its winter floors, and whispers reminders of compassion from a distant world that holds no memory of her. Did she